In the stillness of a droplet, there lies a huntress unlike any other. She is fast, although she doesn't appear to be going anywhere. She has a strategy without a brain, without a single neuron to send clicking commands. Yet, she is one of the most successful predators, inhabiting almost every type of freshwater and marine environment across the globe. She is both patient and relentless. In a world invisible to most, she waits, anchored to a fragment of debris, extending and contracting her neck in a silent rhythm that has played out for millions of years. This is Lacrimaria olor, a single-celled organism whose cell body measures less than 1/20th of a millimeter. The name Lacrimaria olor translates from Latin to the tear of a swan. It's a name that is as poetic as it is accurate. The main body is tear-shaped, and from it extends a long, narrow neck, ending in a head that, when in motion, can resemble a tiny swan, gracefully bending toward unseen prey. The uniqueness of Lacrimaria lies in that neck, a structure that can extend 10, 20, or even 30 times the length of the body. Imagine standing in a grocery store checkout line. It's finally your turn, but you suddenly remember you forgot the treats for your cats. So instead of leaving the line and power walking awkwardly to the far aisle, you send your head along, weaving through the store, turning corners, grabbing the bag and zooming back without moving your body an inch, just in a second. And Lacrimaria doesn't do this as a reaction to an event. It performs it thousands of times over its lifetime, like a primal ritual, like the ebb and flow of the sea. The rhythm may appear random, but at its core it follows a pattern, each movement serving a purpose. At the tip of the long, searching neck rests the head with a tiny cell mouth. This head is armed with dozens of microscopic harpoon-like structures, called the toxocysts, filled with toxins. These are offensive weapons designed for one purpose, to capture and immobilize prey. When the head brushes against the halteria, the toxocysts fire with astonishing speed, piercing the prey's membrane and killing it in less than a heartbeat. The rupture of the prey's membrane releases a flood of chemical cues into the surrounding water. Lacrimaria detects them immediately and knows that its strike was successful. It retracts its neck, repositions its body, and opens its mouth wide to engulf the halteria hole. Much like a snake swallowing prey that looks far too large for its head. In this clip, a Lacrimaria has already struck and killed a smaller prey in an earlier attack, and is now seeking it for ingestion. The mouth opens again, and the prey slides in whole inside. It is quickly enclosed in a membrane, forming something called a food vacuole, a self-contained digestive chamber. Instantly, Lacrimaria starts pumping digestive enzymes into the vacuole, dropping its pH to levels as acidic as our own stomachs. After digestion, nutrients diffuse into the predator's cytoplasm, while the indigestible remains are expelled through the cytoproct. This hypotrich appears to have survived an earlier strike, with part of its cell already missing. Upon a second encounter, Lacrimaria's toxocyst pierces it again, and in an instant, half of the cell dissolves away, leaving the surviving portion to swim off, wounded. I didn't follow the hypotrich, but it looks like it lost more than it can possibly repair. Even larger predatory ciliates like Loxophyllum are not safe from Lacrimaria. Loxophyllum are fearsome in their own right, specializing in prey far more complex than single cells, tiny multicellular animals called rotifers. Rotifers have thousands of cells in their bodies. They have digestive organs, reproductive systems, simple brains, and even eyes. But they fall victim to single-celled Loxophyllum, one after another. In 2018, while setting up my microscope lighting, a slender shape shot into the frame and tore a piece from a loxophyllum. For a few seconds, I was so confused, but then I realized that a Lacrimaria just attacked this loxophyllum. Its head got stuck momentarily, its toxicity dissolving part of the larger predator's cell before letting go. And as Lacrimaria pulled its neck back into the shadows it hit, the wounded loxophyllum swam off, repairing its damaged membrane, perhaps to hunt another rotifer. Such moments reveal Lacrimaria's elegance in power, but its art is truly in the way it searches, reading the water like a map, tracing invisible trails of scent and movement, until they lead it to the next strike. In the wild, Lacrimaria often anchors itself to bits of drifting debris, threads of algae, or fragments of plants. From these hidden footholds, it sends its neck sweeping through the water in graceful arcs, as if searching at random. But after I observe them more and more, what first looked like chaos to me revealed itself as an intricate order, more like the measured taps of a blind person's cane than aimless wandering. Each reach is a deliberate venture into the unknown, the head grazing unseen textures, sensing faint chemical trails, mapping the space in a memory that will never be stored, yet somehow shapes the next move. It is as if Lacrimaria is constantly reading the water, every extension calculated to tilt the odds toward prey, while avoiding predators, ignoring the inedible, and gliding past the countless shapes that offer nothing at all. In this 40-second clip, I wanted to visualize the forward strikes of the neck, which could result in successful food capture. I counted more than 100 strikes, with several reaching beyond the field of view. In this sequence, all strikes targeted only the right-hand side, first the upper right, then shifting to the lower right, as if Lacrimaria was systematically mapping that part of the world. One possible reason for this bias may be chemical gradients in the water. Such gradients may be the cues that lead it to food, since many of Lacrimaria's prey follows these gradient zones. In other cases, Lacrimaria shows remarkable restraint. When touching Paramecium bursaria, it often does not fire its toxicists. Paramecium bursaria has its own defensive structures, called the trichocysts, that launch upon contact from a predator. They work by forming a rigid barrier between predator and the prey. Attacking such prey would waste Lacrimaria's toxicists and require costly resynthesis, so skipping these unwinnable battles would be an efficient choice for a microscopic predator. In much the same, Lacrimaria seems to recognize its own kind. When two individuals meet, they rarely waste their toxicists on one another. It is as if they can tell, at a chemical level, you are made of the same material as me. This self-recognition means it avoids the futile effort of trying to digest what is, in essence, its own blueprint. In multicellular organisms, we can see a similar principle at work in the immune system, where cells must distinguish between self and non-self with extraordinary precision to avoid attacking the body's own tissues. But here in Lacrimaria, that same concept plays out in a single cell. No immune system, no neurons, no network of tissues. Just ancient molecular cues that say friend or foe. The exact mechanisms behind this are still a mystery, but they hint at a level of cellular discernment that feels almost like a primitive intelligence. In the absence of a brain, this kind of recognition is a magnificent feat, an ancient survival strategy refined over millions of years, that lets Lacrimaria save its weapons and energy for battles it can win. And yet, most of these interactions, the hesitations, the skipped attacks, the subtle acknowledgements of self and other happen too quickly and too quietly for us to see, even through a microscope. I expect that as machine learning and real-time tracking technologies advance, we will be able to render these invisible negotiations visible, to trace the fleeting chemical signals, the microsecond decisions, and the unspoken rules that govern life at this scale. When that day comes, I think we'll find that Lacrimaria's world is not as quiet as it seems, but rather full of microbes that communicate loudly enough for the right ears. When I first discovered a population of Lacrimaria in 2018, they instantly become my favorite single-celled organisms. But at first, I thought I was somehow killing these precious little cells. They would extend and hunt for about 10 minutes, then suddenly contract into a still, round form, and I would assume that they are dead, or had lost their necks, or even in the process of dying. This happened again and again in the slides I prepared from that first sample. After a few microscopy sessions, I began to wonder if nothing was actually wrong with them. So I decided to be patient and added drops of water to the slide from the side, so it wouldn't dry out completely. And to my surprise, the Lacrimaria came back to life and resumed their strange dance. And I realized that this was part of their natural rhythm, like sleeping at a microscopic scale. It turned out that these shifts between active hunting and apparent rest are not random pauses. Each change is a complete physical rearrangement of the cell's internal framework that allows the neck to fold and unfold again and again during hunting. When Lacrimaria extends its neck 10 times longer, the neck isn't rebuilt or stretched like an elastic band. It's actually stored away in the cell, coiled and pleated like a living origami. Inside, Lacrimaria has two main systems working together. One is a flexible scaffold that gives the neck its shape, made from long, thin support rods that run in spirals from the tail to the head. The other is a contractile system, like a set of microscopic muscles that can pull the neck back in just as fast as it extends. In its retracted state, the neck is coiled into a tight spiral with the guidance of the scaffolding and folded with remarkable precision. The helix is even and continuous. It turns, wrapping neatly around the body like the threads of a screw. Both the internal scaffolding and the overlying membrane fold into this compact helix. Between each turn lie smaller, finely tuned folds and bends. Allow the neck to compress to a fraction of its full length. When Lacrimaria decides to strike, a small transition zone in the scaffolding of the base of the neck starts to move, and the folds begin to flatten, one after the other, as if a spiraling zipper were opening in slow motion in a controlled way. Tiny structural features guide exactly how the material unrolls. The spiral unwraps, the pleats smooth out, and suddenly, what was once stored in a tiny coil is a slender neck reaching far into the surrounding water. When the strike is over, the process reverses. The neck recoils, the folds reappear in exactly the same place, and the structure is once again stowed away, ready for the next hunt. This choreography, coil, extend, recoil, is so efficient that Lacrimaria can repeat it over and over without the folds wearing out or the structure losing its shape, and all without wasting time and energy building a new neck or growing new cell membrane to extend it. It can go from stillness to a full-length strike in under a second, and do so tens of thousands of times in its life. From the outside, we see only a drifting teardrop with a darting tether. Inside, she is an origami deployment system, fine-tuned by evolution, a huntress built not for constant pursuit, but for sudden reach, decisive strikes, and the patience to wait as still as the droplet she calls home. No wonder I've grown so attached to this brilliant, persistent huntress that if I ever have a daughter, I would want to name her Jane Lacrimaria. Jane for Jane Goodall, whose quiet strength and lifelong devotion to understanding other beings taught me that the boundaries of empathy do not end with our own kind. And Lacrimaria for this tireless beauty, whose elegance and persistence have kept me company. She is to me what Orion once was in the night sky. A patient archer sweeping her bow across the darkness, the way Lacrimaria sweeps her neck through the water, mapping, searching, waiting for the perfect moment to strike. Both have been signs to keep on going, one in the vastness above, and one beneath the same stars. Each a constant presence reminding me that to watch is to learn, and to learn is to step into a kind of freedom carried within, beyond anyone's reach and harm. Thank you for watching. If you'd like to support my work and help me keep exploring these hidden worlds, you can join me on Patreon. Your support makes it possible to spend these long hours at the microscope, chasing stories as small as a cell and as vast as the sky. See you in 2 weeks. Bye.